Welcome back. In an earlier lecture, Professor de Bruin talked about securing public values in infrastructure sectors. With a trend towards deregulation, liberalization, and privatization, it was obvious that public values had to be secured. Here, we want to have a closer look into the process through which public values are defined, how they are secured in specific institutions, and the role of different actors in that process. We will look at the various steps in which public values are defined, how institutions are designed, and this gives us an overview of the different actors and the pitfalls and bottlenecks to be expected. As you are following this MOOC, you probably have or are aspiring a role in one of these infrastructure sectors, or you're just interested because of the news you're confronted with on a day-to-day basis about infrastructures. Let's have a look at this news item.
The adventures of HS2. Episode 1, The Great Train Robbery. One day, Billy, Pat and Bob were minding their own engines when HS2 terminated in front of them. "This is the dead end, mate," said Bob.
"I know, I'm hiding," said HS2.
"What are you hiding from?" asked Pat.
"From the facts," said HS2.
"Well, what sort of facts are you hiding from, HS2? Asked Billy.
"The Treasury says I'll be £73 billion or even more."
"That's like 100 Millennium Domes," said Pat.
"Bloody hell," said Bob, swearing, even though he knew it wasn't allowed on children's TV.
"But won't you solve overcrowding?" said Billy.
"Only by a fraction."
"But you save 35 minutes from London to Birmingham," said Bob.
"After spending tens of billions of pounds, I'll actually only save 20 minutes.
"But that's criminal," said Bob.
"Camden will be a building site for 8 years, said HS2.
"I bought some leather trousers in Camden Market once," said Pat, rather unexpectedly.
"I will ruin 34 ancient woodlands, destroy 300 miles of hedgerows, devastate communities, and destroy unique wildlife habitats."
"That's bonkers," said Billy.
"The only single diversion I make is around the most affluent part of George Osborne's constituency, at an additional cost to the taxpayer of £600 million, said HS2 with a wink.
The engines were fuming. The case for HS2 was so depressing, it made them all want to throw themselves under a passing train.
"You can't hide from the facts any longer," said Billy.
"Oh, I nearly forgot. £8 billion will be cut from existing rail services and stations across the country, including Wakefield, just to pay for me."
"Bollocks to that," said Bob, as the engines made it clear they wanted to shunt HS2 right up the junction.
In the video, you see a lobby group counter the public values the UK government claims for the high-speed railway line too. It will trigger investments and it will improve the mobility with a clean mode of transport. The lobbyists claim ineffective use of government money and environmental damage. It shows the variety of public values that people are looking at when evaluating infrastructures. Let's look at this discussion from the perspective of public values a bit more. So, what are public values anyway? Public values are those values that governments have adopted to secure. The answer to whether or not a value is a possible public value can be addressed in various ways. On the one hand, there's a lot of normative theory. Economists like Baumol tend to limit the role of government to specific situations of market failure through mechanisms that drive out normal, informed competition. Policy scientists like Bozeman and Beck-Jurgensen focus on lists and categorization of typical public values. Now, from our perspective, let's look at it more empirically. It makes sense that any value secured through a formal government decision-making process is a public value. So, when in democratic countries, parliament decides that all trains should have toilets or buses should be burgundy red because of improved quality, this is a de facto public value. Obviously, it all starts with the moment that governments become concerned with these values. Let's look at it in a bit closer on how these steps go through a democratic process. Let's look at step one, advocacy. This is a step between the voting citizen and the legislator. In a democratic society, the voters can put values on the agenda, the values they want to be secured. parties or representatives are expected to pick up on these values. There is an abundant normative theory on how that democratic process should run. Elections are the key moments in which voters are expressing their view on what's important values, what they think is important for society. Periodic elections would make for a limited shift in the valuation of different public values, every 4 year new values. However, in reality, the democratic process is much more dynamic. When a train accident occurs, the legislator is concerned about railway safety, often inducing further regulation of that value. In this process, the media plays an important role. It sets the agenda of legislative branches, parliaments and representative bodies in all shapes and forms between elections. Let's move to step two, where policies are developed. Legislators work in formal decision-making with executive branches, ministries, secretaries, departments, to deal with specific public values. In the interaction between the legislator and the executive, public values often are dealt with separately as feel-good concepts. Who could oppose to improve privacy, safety, punctuality, accessibility, reliability, etc.? We'll see in later steps how this can be problematic. In normative theory, how things should go, these entities are an instrument for their specific task. Departments are set up and their role is to translate the broadly formulated feel-good concepts from Parliament into more focused instruments of intervention. In reality, less productive mechanisms are at play as well. We see politics of bureaucracy in action, organizations struggling for budgets, legitimation, and influence. We see goal displacement, where the original intent for the agency set up to secure a public value is substituted by the agency drawing its own course. In a third step, agencies go to work based on these policies. Specific regulators of sectors, markets, specific public values like safety, they're all overseeing providers of infrastructure-related services. They direct and measure the performance of the providers on a specific set of parameters related to public values and develop positive and negative incentives to secure the public value in the management and operation of the providers. Market regulators look at competition-disturbing behavior, safety inspectorates at potential dangerous operations. Regulation of providers has proven hard. Providers know their infrastructure systems much better than their overseeing regulators. They can use that information to their strategic advantage. Now the last step is delivery. Providers offer their services to the customer. This is where the provider has to make good on the promise of the feel-good concepts as discussed earlier in this circular chain. This is also where the trade-offs become most apparent. A railway operator has to be punctual, safe, cheap, clean, quick, and that all at the same time, and has to make a trade-off between all these. Obviously, the circle is a simplification. The department and the provider sectors of the circle are layered themselves. The executive department consists of bureaucratic entities from the ministry or department itself to other agencies like inspectorates and quangos, police and justice, transport authorities, and telecommunication regulators. Some of these agencies are related to a specific public value, like privacy or safety or a market watchdog. And some have a broader task, like a general department. Also, providers are layered and multifaceted. In many infrastructures, we see a distinction between the provider of infrastructure capacity, a network manager, and the provider of a transport service, transport operators. An infrastructure manager and transport operators often are different entities in geographical levels and areas. What happens to public values when they go through this circle? Well, first of all, the feel-good concepts are translated into more operational measures of performance. In that process, they become sharper instruments for intervention for the departments to use. But they also become more narrow. This allows for strategic behavior of the provider, possibly missing the original intent and sometimes developed without regard for the operational complexity. Let's look at an example. Punctuality makes sense as a feel-good concept in public transport. But to secure it, the department has to secure it through operationalization. For example, the percentage of buses departing within 3 minutes of the scheduled departure time, and it has to set up a penalty, for example, when the percentage is below 90%. Now, the provider of the bus service can cancel bus services that are running late to reach the performance threshold and avoid the penalty. Or the operational speed might be reduced to meet the punctuality demands. Or the provider might be penalized because of growing congestion, something that he has no influence over. It shows how important good operationalization is and how hard it can be to find the right measure. Second, separate public values go through separate paths from adoption as separate feel-good concepts in Parliament through laws, agencies, contracts, licenses, and the management of the provider of the service. Eventually, in that operation of the provider, all these public values have to be delivered upon. The services has to be safe, clean, accessible, reliable, affordable, and much more. All the interventions aimed to secure separate public values come together in the way that the trains are run, the servers are set up, the water is delivered, the sewerage is disposed of. Providers are coping with various conflicting interventions, if only in the way that the provider is spending its limited funds on to comply with all these different values. Often, the conflicts are direct. For example, the demand of availability and speed in public transport. Stopping a bus a lot improves the availability passengers can get on more places, but it harms operational speed. Simply, the bus has to stop more and go slower. So, different paths to secure various public values all come together in the operation of the provider. And this adds to the already complex situation, technical situation, operational situation of providing the service. Third, public values are secured in laws secured through agencies, defined in contracts, concessions or licenses, and various public values have found a specific institutional form in which they are secured in a relatively stable system. The reality of performance of infrastructure leads to constant attention for different public values and subsequent tinkering on these institutions. A lot happens to public values from the feel-good concept to the operation of the provider. Often this leads to the outcomes being hard to recognize from the perspective of the original intent. Consumers feel a disconnect from the promises that they were made when they were voters. So, in this module, we looked at public values in a bit more detail. Securing public values is done in various types of institutions. Public values in the public debate are often feel-good concepts with a great deal of current debate on separate values and attention that they need to get. Public values go through a transformation process from that feel-good concept to very explicit measures of performance. And in operation, many of these measures of performance condition the operation and might conflict. If you are or will be working in one of the mentioned roles, I hope the overview provided you with some help in understanding the fragmentation of the sector and how that hinders securing public values and infrastructures. And I hope it helps you to have a more integrated perspective on the process and will lead to better results in the infrastructure sectors we're looking at. Thanks.